got to the end, had a little fun. Yeah, that was something else. Man, I always had a thing, you know. I got to tell you guys, so being left-handed, all these years I spent a lot of time trying to, like, figure stuff out lefty. And it was really a challenge, you know. So over the years, I started to try to assimilate some of these right-handed grooves, especially when it comes to Neil Peart. You know, this guy is playing huge kit with, you know, tons of cymbals and all kinds of crazy stuff. And, of course, that crazy ride cymbal pattern that he plays. It's important to, you know, to kind of do that stuff right-handed, you know. So, you know, it's kind of one of the things you got to do in order to get it to work. But being a lefty guy, I'm always struggling to kind of keep up with some of the parts. So, you know, it happens. Things go wrong. It is what it is. You know. But yeah, that ending, man, is super complicated, and I always mess it up. Does anybody have any specific questions about parts of the song? Anything they want to go over? You know, check some things out. Does anybody have any questions? I didn't see any questions go by. Nobody said nothing. So I'm just going to go over some parts. You guys can listen, and hopefully y'all will dig it. So song starts out, and it's in a time signature called 7/8, which means there's only 7/8 notes per measure. Okay, so this little pattern starts out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the kicks are with the 1, 3, and the 5. 1, 3, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, hi hats playing 16th notes, right? You got that little dugga, two snares, second time, splash, splash, back to the dugga, dugga, you know, two snares for the next two times around, and then song shifts into 4/4 time. That's 4 quarter notes per measure. 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So, you know, it's cruising along, 16th notes, and we get into that ride cymbal pattern that I kind of talked about a couple times over the last couple of weeks. It's that split part between the hi-hat and the ride cymbal, where you're playing foot, left, right, left, foot, left, right, left. Now, the backbeat comes in on beat 3 with the right hand on the snare, and then there's the extra two left hands that kind of kick in on the E's and U's. There's a tricky little pattern in there. The hardest part for everybody to get is gonna be that. So all it is that left hand coming in, snare, kick, snare, and then ride comes back, and then the left hand goes back to the hi-hat. So if you're struggling with that part, work on that exchange. Snare, kick, snare, ride. All right, so moving on from there, you know, we kind of go into this first fill section where he kind of hits those crashes. Dun, ka, dun, right? Now here there's some debatable parts in terms of whatever transcriptions you read. Some people are going to do it a little bit differently. What I'm doing is I'm playing a triplet starting with the left hand. So there's a triplet, digga-da, right, starting with the left, it finishes with the right when you get to the end on the crash. However, if you want to try to play 4 notes, I've seen it transcribed that way as well, right? So on the tom it would be. So there's 2 different ways about it, but the, you know, that's kind of what's going on there. You got this next fill that he's kind of doing this kind of mixture of snare, tom, you know, kind of coming around. So we got this kind of thing, right? So we got. It kind of goes over the bar line into the next part, and there's a kick right before the snare drum comes in with the china on the two, you know, snare and the china together on 2 beats, right? So we start with the right hand. So, mixture between the right and the left here, make sure you're getting that exchange. Okay, again, it's a little bit different with a smaller kit versus having a big kit with some more toms. You know, having a second tom here, and then Neil also has the high tom that he uses that's kind of tuned up that gives it that kind of orchestration sound. So we're going to double chinas, blah, 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 going cruising on from there, right? Into the main groove of the song, and, you know, there's not a whole lot going on there. It's just kind of straight quarter note rock, kind of keeping, you know, keeping that going. Now, the first time it goes back to the odd time signature, it gets into seven. Now, again, here's a debate about, you know, which way to play it, but it's all been revealed now that we've seen Neil do it live. He does it with a double left hand, but I always learned it with left, right, or two hands. So, it, you know, it's something that I just got comfortable doing, and I've just done it ever since. So we got this part where, But if you're gonna play it the way Neil plays it, then you got. So it's again in 7/8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1. And the open hi-hat is on 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, deca 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 7, 1, right? Da-da-da. Got that double stroke happen at the end there, okay? So that's the next, the first time it goes back into the seven. All right, so you want to be conscious of that. For those of you who are readers, this is a good book, Drum Techniques of Rush. The transcription, you know, again, there's some things that people would disagree with nowadays as far as certain parts of the song, but, you know, don't worry about it. Just kind of, you know, learn it. From this, learn it from the videos that you see of Neil doing it. There's some transcriptions on YouTube. There's a whole bunch of ways to do it. You know, just figure it out as best you can. All right, so goes back to 4/4 for a minute, and then we're going to go back to the 7 for a second time. Now, you'll notice that I did play this the right-handed way, meaning I led my hi-hat on the right side instead of playing open-handed, which I do a lot of the time. So this next part in 7 is kind of cool, where we got a two-bar phrase. Make sure that you learn both halves and cycle it in order to make sure that you get it appropriate, right? Okay, so we get to the first time that we really start doing this, like, groups of 3/16th notes that Neil does. He uses this idea a lot in this song, and it starts to build as it gets, you know, more and more deep into the tune. One of the things that we got to be comfortable with right out of the gate is this right, left, like triplets, but it's played in 16th notes. Or, you know, so it grows across the measure as a 16th note. But if you're practicing triplets and accents on triplets, it's going to help you when you play this particular thing. So you're just going to get, you know, sit down with the basics and just start doing right? Start with accenting the first note of a group of three notes on the snare. Start by moving the right hand to the first tom and play a triplet. And then the opposite. So right, left, right, left. Get really comfortable with that and then start to speed it up. Move the same thing, but to the hi-hat. So now your one target is now the hi-hat, right? Add the bass drum to the right hand and the left hand on top, layered on top. So and then from there, you gotta lift up the front of your foot on the left on the hi-hat to get the open and close going, right? You're gonna wanna work on this a lot because, as you may or may not know, the rest of the tune, the fills are longer when it has this. This is just only two of them. There's four of them every other time he does it. So, gotta be comfortable with that, right? Okay, so that's at the end of each, you know, two-bar phrase in 7. So you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's bugga-da, bugga-da, boom, at the end, right? Okay, does that a few times, and we go back into 4/4 for a bit, cruising on that, and then we get into this next section of the song where it basically changes 6/4 time. So there's six quarter notes per measure. One, two, three, four, five, six, one, before it turns around. Okay, so again, it's like a two bar thing. The phrases come around, one, two, and three, and four, five, six, one, two, and three, and four, five, and six, and one. Okay, so he kind of reiterates this phrase a lot through the remaining of this section of the tune. There's a lot of this six going on. So I suggest you count it in six. The transcription book is written out in mostly in four, so it's like four and then two, and then it starts again in the middle of the next measure, and it's kind of weird. It's a little bit easier if you just learn the whole thing in six. One, two, and three, four, five, and six. One, two, and three, four, five, and six, and one, right? So you got one. And three and four, five, six, and one, two, and three, and four, five, and six, and one, okay? Get that locked in into your brain, and then it'll help you for the remainder of this section of the tune. And that'll be helpful, okay? You got the double snare thing, then he accents the vocal. And then the next time we do this fill, we got four of these hi-hats alternating between the hi-hat and the snare drum. So we got... One, two, three, four, one. Again, it's 16th notes, but played in groups of three. So it's 4E and a 5E and a 6E and a 1, right? So it starts on the fourth beat, 1, 2, and 3, and 4E and a 5 and a 6E and a 1, okay? Da-ga-da-da-ga-da-da-ga-da-da-da, all right, comes around. So work on that, get that movement going. It's good to know. You'll be able to play the beginning of the ZZ Top LaGrange once you get this lick down. So, you know, it's useful for other things too. All right. So, see if I'm missing any questions over here. People coming in, but I don't see. What are you guys doing? How do you do the right hi-hat left hand right over right hand switch? Is that what you were asking me about, Jeff, a little few minutes ago about this alternating thing? I hope I cleared that up for you. You know, but that's kind of the main thing. Some guys try to do it double left, and that makes it really tricky if you don't have a strong left hand. Da 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 da. Right? That's another way to do it, but it's, you know, it's not as strong unless you, you know, have really worked on doubles with your left hand at that tempo. So, you know, it's worth it to work that out. All right. So, beyond that, you know, moving along in the transcription here, we got this little thing here. We got dugga dugga bum 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 bum. 4/16th notes. Crash, crash, crash. And then there's a slight pause before it goes and one to the next one. Okay? So just make sure you give it that little pause, because if you rush it, then it'll come in too soon to the downbeat. All right, moving on. We got this big old fill coming up in the next section before, you know, actually I gotta go over the ride cymbal part, but we'll get to that in a second. So this big fill at the end of this next section, we got again, four of these, blah-ga-da, 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 right? And then you're gonna move it around the drums, okay? So we got. The ending of the fill, right? First part. So right, left, right, down to here, back to the snare. Left hand goes up, and then the right hand stays on the snare, and then the left hand comes back for the last four notes. Okay. Let me just back up real quick. Neil Peart ride cymbal pattern, right? He plays this a lot in this tune. Ding, da da ga ding, da da ga da ding is the normal one, right? Ding, da da ga ding, da da ga da ding in 4/4, right? So this is 6/4, so we got to extend it. So it's boom, da 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 dun, da da ga da dun, da 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 ga, and then it starts again, okay? So we got an extra di da da ga at the end. What I mean by that is going to be like this. 5 and a 6 to finish it, okay? 1 and a 2 and 3 and a 4 and 5 and a 6. Okay, so spend some time getting comfortable with that. It's one of the few times that he does this in 6. Spirit of the Radio is in 4. Red Barchetta's in 4. There's like, you know, other times he does this same ride cymbal thing, but it's in 4 times. So this one's in 6. So it's interesting and cool because of that. So you got to make sure that you check that out. All right. So we did the big fill, and then we go back to 7/8 with that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Back to the 4/4, just like at the beginning. Dug it, 16th notes, 3/4. Right. Then we're gonna do this little crazy little 7/8 pattern, which you're supposed to do this 3 times. Okay, so what's happening there is we're still playing in 7. Now, the other thing is if you watch Neil live in more recent times, he actually plays a combination between the hi-hat and the snare drum on this section too, where he goes. I can't even do it because I never worked on it. so that part I missed out on, you know, so whatever, it is what it is, you know what I mean? So either way, that part's in 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? And then we got this fill that goes. Okay, then we're going to crash on the china a little bit, doom doom, okay, getting out of that. Then we're just gonna go to a straight 4/4, ride cymbal hi-hat. Now this next section for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 bars is in 7 again. So we got 1, 2, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But it kind of does this alternating turnaround thing. So we got. So tricky there because you got to get work on that open hi-hat. While the bass drum is in between, doing this kind of polka beat almost. So, it's kind of like that. And then we do this crash thing for a bit. Back to the 6/4 for a while. We do another one of these. Back into that for a bit. There's a lick here. It goes China. There's that one, and he does this one where he does this kind of offbeat china. Check that one out, it's good. Then it goes into the guitar solo, okay? Once you get into this part of the tune, starts to get a little bit crazier with the fills. Now, this is a challenge because if you don't have the Neil Peart setup, you can't do the big tom run that he does where he starts up on like the, you know, the high tom that's above his hi-hat. So we got to kind of fake it with this one if you're playing a small kit, all right? So this is the way I fake it. Sorry, I start on the snare. Okay, this is a faker for four-piece kit players, okay? Flam on the snare, da-da-do-do, and then instead of working your way down your lower drums, which is what Neil would do, you just go back up to the first tom and play down here. Okay, so he starts up here. You know what I mean? So he kind of works his way down the kit a little bit. We can't do that, so we got to make an adjustment. So we go. So we go. A little bit slower. This goes like that. So one more time. Okay. So that's a cool fill. And then staying on that ride cymbal pattern, ding, did the get a ding, make sure it's in six. And then we got this, the fill that's going to start with the opens again. So we got. So the way I do that is dugga, 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 bugga, dugga. There's a snare in there coming back, you know. There's a little bit of a, you know, gray area in terms of how he does it, but figure out what you got to do. And then we got one more big fill, which we're going to kind of do a similar thing, a fake out to the one that I just did. Instead of starting with the flam on the snare, we're going to start on the first tom. Okay. So, crash, 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 crash. So again, we're playing those groups of three again. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. Right hand, right foot, left hand, right foot. So those, you know, the hands and feet have to be locked in. Okay, that's the last lick before we get into the 6-4 at the end where he's playing this groove that's split between the ride cymbal and the china. So trick is to work on it without the china type first and then get the china added in after. So, because it's going to be kind of tricky, so you go. Again, remember it's in 6-4, 1. Two and E and four and E and six and one. Two and E and four and E and six and one. Okay, and then you got one. Now, if you get real fancy, you can add some of the double strokes that he does the third time around. So it's going to be. Okay. That's a fun one. And then we're going to go into this double time thing a little bit where he goes still in 6-4. And then comes the last part, my worst nemesis, the tricky part at the end, where we go. Okay, that's the end. I like right, left, left for all those three counts. Okay, well, the professor would disagree with you on that. He plays them all single-stroked. However, whatever works for you, you know, it's the best you can do. So again, so this last fill, right? So we got. So, I learned that last chunk from watching him do it live. He does a single thing with the two, so it's. Right, so you got. Okay. The professor's always right. That's true. So, yeah. That's kind of the ending thing. There's a little orchestrated part at the end. And then he does a little cymbal swell. It's kind of a, you know, more of an orchestrated thing where they would watch each other to hit it right. So that's kind of the basics, guys. So still looking to see if anybody's got any specific questions for me over here. I see. Tad Newman joined the house, man. That's crazy. my drum teacher from when I was a youngster. Tad, man, again, I appreciate you guiding me through all that craziness when I was a kid. Tad was one of the ones that was instrumental in me learning how to play open-handed, meaning the hi-hat over here and the ride cymbal over here, and spending a lot of time working on both. You know, there's still an innate thing in your body that, like, you know, your brain likes to connect one side to the other. So it makes it a little bit challenging as far as some other stuff goes, because I still like to lead weird ways and do left foot lead and some fills and left foot bass drums and all kinds of crazy stuff. But spent a lot of time working the right side to build up an evenness with the left side, so that therefore you can play, you know, whatever you want on one side, you can also do, double it and do it on the other side. So, you know, it's a great technique to develop as a drummer. A lot of guys complain about, their left hand is too weak, man. I can't get good double strokes with my left hand, you know. So sometimes it just takes a little bit more focus with that other side to kind of get it going, you know, making sure that you're approaching the left hand. You know, it's cool to be like doing, you know, even some more simple stuff to get started, like, you know, Don't Stop Believing even. Learning that whole pattern is a lot of fun, but you're riding that hi-hat with the left hand, backbeating with the right hand, gives you the freedom to move around the kit, and that's why Steve Smith did it that way from Journey. So, you know, it's a cool thing to be able to do. Not only that, like, you know, if you watch my guys like Morgan Rose from Seven Dust, or you watch Tommy Lee from Motley Crue, you notice that these guys are switching a lot, you know, hi-hat wise. They're always playing a little things and they do their little tricks, you know, and that's not necessarily, the tricks aren't the most important part, but you're actually getting a little bit of lead from both sides of the kit when you do that. So it kind of helps you to be able to play on both sides a little bit. Remember to practice, you know, in this song especially, that left-handed unison with a cymbal. If you're a right-handed player, getting that left to lock in with the bass drum is very key. You know, it's an off beat, so we get that, you know, one E, a two, and a three, E, and a four, E, and a one. It's kind of like, you know, again, it's like a triplet, but played over a 16th note phrase. So one E, and a two, E, and a three, E, and a four. Hey, sis, how are you? Good to see you. Yeah, so alternating 16th notes, but accenting every third note, locking in that right on the one, and then the third note with the left. With the right foot, so you gotta make sure that locks in. guys rock it, and we'll talk to you soon, okay? Be safe. Thanks.